symposium there last week on in relationship to the exhibition, and again thinking through some of the objects in the exhibition, but again the wider questions around the periods, and to borrow the terminology of this seminar, modes of making, thinking particularly beyond painting and sculpture. And I think our speakers in this seminar as well will be getting us to think about spaces through exhibitions, technologies, forms of experimentation across visual cultures. So I know we're in for a very rich conversation this evening. I've got to do a bit of housekeeping, just start off with some of the very practical information as well. There's no fire alarm planned for this evening, so if the alarms do go off, it's real. We need to get out of the building. You need to vacate through this door, down the stairs, and members of staff will direct you to the gathering point on the square. We also have a chance for a Q&A session after our we've heard our talks, and we really welcome conversation in the room, but also we always have a really lively online audience, and we want to hear from you watching wherever you are in the world. So please do use the chat function during the talk and the Q&A box if you want to ask a question, and then I'll be able to put those to our chair and our speakers. But without further ado, I want to introduce our chair for this evening. It's a real pleasure to welcome Lucy Reynolds back to the Paul Mellon Centre. Lucy has lectured and published extensively, and her research focuses on questions of moving image, feminism, political space, and collective practice. She's edited the anthology Women Artists, Feminism and the Moving Image, and co-edited Artists Moving Image in Britain since 1989, which we were very proud to publish through the Paul Mellon Centre and workshop and work collaboratively on that publication. She also co-edits the Moving Image Review and Art Journal. Mirage, M-R-I-A-J. She also coordinates the PhD programme for the Centre for Research in Education, Art and Media at the University of Westminster. So Lucy, thank you so much for coming to chair this conversation, your expertise on moving images, images in movement, and thinking across modes of making will be so valuable as we think through Rosie and Inga's paper. So Lucy, over to you.
So thanks very much, Sarah. And what a treat as well for me, because moving images you have from my biography is very much my area of scholarship, but it's not really, it's about something that we were talking about a little bit before when we were just discussing and preparing for today. It's about the intermedial, in a sense. It's about where moving image touches other contemporary practices of their moment. And for me, the other pleasure about this is what an extraordinary moment this was, this post-war moment. Even, you know, talking to students now, which war? You know, there's a sense that this particular post-45 moment that was for the Barbican show has so much for us to reflect on in terms of the art that we're seeing and making now. So I think, again, Sarah's focus on making here is really important. I'm very excited to be hearing the papers and to have an excuse to come here and discuss it with them and to open it up to you as well. So without wishing to take up any more time myself, I'm going to just quickly talk about the structure of our, well, I know Sarah's already talked to that a little bit, but to say that first Inga Fraser will give her paper, followed by Rosie Ram. Then we'll hopefully have about a little bit of time where I'll be in discussion with them. Then I'm going to open it up to you online or here in person for your questions. So that should take us to about 7:30, I think, and then drinks, and probably more discussions there. So I'd just like to start by giving you Inga's biography. So Inga Fraser is a curator and art historian. She's currently a doctoral researcher working on a collaborative project with Tate and the Royal College of Art that engages artists and explores artists' engagement with film. Her thesis focuses on artists working in London in the first half of the 20th century, intermedial practices, and developing discourses of artists' moving image. She also teaches at the Courtauld Institute of Art And before beginning her doctoral research, Inga was assistant curator of modern British art at Tate. Previously, she held curatorial positions at the National Portrait Gallery and Central St. Martin's in London, and has written for journals and magazines, including Document, Tate, etc., British Art Studies, Sculpture Journal, and Costume, as well as books and catalogues published by Koenig, Ashgate, and Tate. And very delighted to welcome you to tell us more about Oswald Blakeston, The Magic Aftermath.
Sorry, that's a big clunk. I actually wondered who came up with the title Liquid Crystal Concrete, Sarah, because it was such a kind of evocative series of words, and I've kind of used them in my talk, so thank you for that. I'll just scoot on. No, I won't. End of slideshow.
Sorry, I'll get you that.
Okay, great. So my aim for this paper is to fill out the picture of the post-war British art world, even beyond the tentacles that the fantastic Barbican exhibition Post-War British Art begins to unfurl. I was lucky to alight upon Blakeston in the course of my thesis research, and able through his archive to trace a winding path that traverses disciplinary and historiographical boundaries, producing a different map of the connections between artists and their practices in the post-war period. So this paper is as much about these contacts and encounters as about Blakeston himself. I have three reflections to keep in mind. Firstly, the difference between intentional and unintentional fragility of experimental works made during the period. Secondly, the legacy of film in terms of both production and exhibition for post-war interdisciplinary practices. And thirdly, that despite the boundary line laid down by the post in post-war, the tentacular paths we are following with Blakeston, and indeed many other artists working in the period, lead back to the pre-war, whether in terms of unfinished business or to issue a new challenge to those ideologies. The writer Mulk Raj Anand wrote to Blakeston in 1982 after a long absence. He said, "Someone told me you're alive and well, that you are painting now more than writing. I can only guess that you have taken up what you used to do even in the early 30s. And this is what I meant to indicate with the paper's title, borrowed from a book by Blakeston published in 1932. So I hope to draw attention to a number of post-war pleats today. Oswald Blakeston was born Henry Joseph Haslacher to parents of Austrian heritage in May 1907 in Surrey. He left home at 16 and eventually found work as a camera boy in Gaumont's Lime Grove Studios alongside a similarly gauche David Lean. Rising to be an assistant director at Islington Studios, he gained an intimate knowledge of the operations of the film industry during this period, which he would later draw on for several technical books on the cinema, as well as for his own artistic works in film and other media. His circle during the interwar years was wide and international, including such figures as Francis Brugier, Lance Siefking, Jack Bilbo, Frank Dobson, Ober Holloway, Len Lai, Paul Rother, Andor Krasner-Kraus, and Dr. K.S. Bart. Blakeston met the artist Max Chapman in the late 1920s, and they became lifelong partners. They were both pacifists, and in the 1930s and 40s, they lived between Cornwall and London. So returning to London post-war, Blakeston found his 30s circle somewhat dispersed. He was buoyed personally through close correspondence and financially by the gift of regular sums of money by his friend since the 1920s, the writer and heiress Briar. Otherwise, his income during this time was largely derived from his journalistic writing. Consequently, he wrote for a huge number of publications. As the writer Ian Young later asked, "How could you categorize a man whose work has appeared everywhere from Gay News to the Mortician's Gazette?" Blakeston worked as an art critic alongside Dennis Bowen and Yasha Reichardt for a number of publications post-war, including Art News and Review and What's On. Alongside these more conventional forms of writing, Blakeston pursued more experimental modes. He published a book of one-word poems, and got to know Stefan and Francesca Temerson, whose own transmedial explorations in art were, like his own, grounded in pre-war experimental film culture. Francesca Temerson designed the cover for Blakeston's novel Hop Thief in 1959, and the Temersons' Gabbabocas Press published Blakeston's novels The Night's Moves, also with a cover by Francesca, and Fingers from 1964. Blakeston wrote a preface for the Gabbabocas 1962 edition of Anatole Stern's long poem Europa from 1925, which also reproduced stills from the Temersons' 1930 film Europa, which was based on Stern's poem. With its dynamic juxtaposition of text, image, and graphics, the book mirrored some of Blakeston's own pre-war experiments that combined still photography and text in forms that aspired to be cinematic. This type of intermedial or transmedial address was to some extent considered an unfinished project by artists and writers in the post-war period. As the poet Michael Horowitz notes in his introduction, there is still no English for collage. Here I just wanted to flag this excellent catalogue of the Temersons archive. You can access it in the Tate Library, but it's so extensive and includes Blakeston. So Blakeston also wrote for the Trigram Press, another publisher who attempted to counter prevailing insularity in the post-war English literary scene. His book was actually the first they published, a book of his poetry printed on different coloured paper titled How to Make Your Own Confetti. It was illustrated by Max Chapman. And here's Blakeston with Trigram's Pip and Asa Benveniste. Blakeston's connection to the burgeoning 1960s experimental poetry and art scene was by no means consistent, though, and often came via his local connections in Hampstead and North London. One such connection appears to have been the poet and organiser Bob Cobbing. And so like Blakeston, Cobbing was a conscientious objector during the Second World War, and like Blakeston, he cultivated an interest in experimental forms of poetry and film. Blakeston evidently knew about Cobbing's work at Better Books, and their work was included in an exhibition together in 1967 at the Foyer Gallery in Hampstead with other artists affiliated with the Free Painters and Sculptors Group. This is a photograph of one of them from slightly earlier. One of the essays in this collection about Bob Cobbing's life and work by Max Azzola outlines the way in which post-war film societies, such as the Hendon Film Society, with which Bob Cobbing was involved, continued the pre-war tradition of showing a diverse programme incorporating early silent cinema, avant-garde and scientific films, and documentaries. Here I want to suggest that this inclusive pre-war mode of film consumption may have provided a model for post-war interdisciplinarity in literary and visual art, something both Cobbing and Blakeston were preoccupied with. So, liquid. Although Blakeston had earlier drawn and painted, as this photograph testifies, his first official one-man show is dated by Max Chapman to 1958 and took place at the Coffee Pot in Berwick Street. Dennis Bone describes the prejudice faced by abstract painters beyond a select few in London galleries in the 1950s, and notes that the new wave of coffee shops in Soho were among the only venues open to young artists hoping to show their work. In his correspondence with the poet Breyer, Blakeston appears to have stated apprehension about his career as a painter. But in June 1962, she reassures Blakeston, writing, "Of course you should paint. I'm interested in what you have been doing with your watercolours. I do hope you can find a place for your show." Blakeston went on to exhibit his paintings with some success at galleries, including the Grabowski, New Vision Centre Gallery, the Foyer Gallery, and the Drian Gallery. And here I'm just going to skip through a whole run of slides that I had to cut because presentation was too long. So this is a potted look at Oswald Blakeston's painting career. At these galleries, artists who found themselves on the edge of the established art world, both as a result of style and nationality, found welcome. At these galleries and others, including Gallery One, Signals and Indica, the welcome would increasingly extend to those who, like Blakeston, began experimenting with non-traditional media. So ask me questions about these artists afterwards. So Blakeston often foregrounded the use of experimental materials by artists in his work as a critic, writing, for instance, a text for the German emigre artist Walter Nessler's exhibition of polyester paintings at the Madden Galleries in 1964. And this interest stems from his own artistic practice. In 1962, Oswald Blakeston staged an exhibition of his work at the New Vision Centre Gallery titled Crystal Graphs. He explained, "In the 50s, I wanted to paint with chemicals which would crystallize on the canvas. A friend, a backroom research boffin, said it was impossible. I went to my local chemist, who looked startled, but concocted some experimental solutions. I then went to the embassy of a country boasting a new fixative for paint on combat planes, and I came away with a small bottle of the secret formula. Dennis hung my first ever crystal paintings, and we got the first ever art reviews in papers like The Chemist and Druggist." And there are cuttings in the New Vision Centre scrapbooks from this industry periodical Chemical Age. Cotty Berlin, curator at the Abbey Arts Centre, writing in the Arts Review, described the crystallographs, that's his own spelling, deposit glittering purple crystals along linear patterns drawn broadly on the tinted papers. They appear to read as secret writing on a background of abstract events. I've been unable to track down with any certainty an example of Blakeston's crystal graphs. This work was included in a 2002 auction at Bonhams, reproduced at about that big in the catalogue, and could potentially have been a crystal graph. It's recorded just as mixed media on canvas. And despite lots of help from the auctioneers, the trail has run cold, so consider this a call out. But I also think there's a point here about the intentional ephemerality of experimental media. At the time, Blakeston referred to the crystal graphs as experiments, thus foregrounding their nature as speculative, tentative, and perhaps not intended to persist. He described how nowadays artists are always searching for new mediums to work with and in: polyester resin, vinylac, ground metal, components from the factory yard, etc., concluding that this was an attempt to bring, and I quote, "the chaos of the modern world around us under some harmonious control." This conception locates such works more resolutely in their own historical moment, and elsewhere, Blakeston expressed the view that this is perhaps where such experimental work should remain. In response to an exhibition request for his 1929 abstract film Light Rhythms, he was reluctant, arguing that such works had a point when they were made years before light sculpture and the kinetic boxes of Healy. Now they're inevitably superseded. In 1966, Blakeston's work was included in Soundings 3 at Signals Gallery, an exhibition of abstract art organised by David Medalla. Signals cultivated a particular interest in kinetic works and sculpture made from a variety of materials, and in the pages of the Signals News Bulletin, edited by Medalla, the legacy of artists working in a similar way prior to the Second World War is made explicit. So here is the June-July 1965 issue, for example, which includes excerpts from Moholy Nagy's The New Vision and Garbo and Pevsner's Realistic Manifesto. Hopefully you can see that. It was at Signals and other spaces showing constructivist and abstract works that, as Ming Tiampo has recently pointed out, dialogues were staged between the apparent universals of pre and some post-war modernism, with diaspora perspectives playing a key role in challenging and particularizing these forms. For Blakeston, the technology that he had been so engaged with pre-war, film and television, with its own metaphors of crystal gazing, continued to be of interest into the 1960s. In 1962, he and the German photographer Hans Kasparius, who he had known since the 1920s, became involved in a new experimental collaboration involving film. Copies of letters in Blakeston's archive from Kasparius in 1963 record the intention behind the project. He writes to J. Parry Green of Fiberglass Limited, quote, "We have been told that a lady in America dropped a marble by chance into boiling water. It cracked immediately and opened up. In cracking, the color inside the marble unfolded like a flower opening into a display of brilliant color. We are hoping to produce this effect and to photograph this opening and spreading of color with a high-speed camera." Preceding this correspondence are a number of letters to Blakeston from people responding to an advertisement he placed in the Exchange in Mart, requesting marbles for purchase. And there's also an information sheet about the Wollensack Fast X and Eastman high-speed cameras. Unfortunately, the project was not realised, evidently due to the expense of hiring the camera, which you had to hire people to operate it as well, evidently. Another of Blakeston's pre-war acquaintances, David Rawnsley, made the move from pre-war work in film to post-war painting with a focus on experimental methods. Rawnsley had worked in the film industry, primarily as a set designer for directors including David Lean and Paul and Pressburger. He proposed a new system of working in the post-war period known as independent frame. The system sought to rationalize a number of inefficiencies in a film industry striving for realism. Rather than location shooting and the use of expensive real or highly naturalistic props, Rawnsley's system deployed closely worked preparatory drawings and back projection to ensure that a setting could be created with fewer resources. One of the effects of these methods was that potentially it could facilitate, and I quote, an overall system of imagistic substitution, allowing for greater artistry and abstraction in film design. This control over the film production process was precisely what many commercial and non-commercial directors and filmmakers such as George Pearson and Edward Carrick, as well as Blakeston, were striving for before the war. But independent frame was not taken up at scale by the industry, and despite some early success, was largely deemed a failure. As a result, Rawnsley focused his interest on other media after the war, working alongside Joyce Morgan on a ceramics workshop in Paris, and in 1952, co-founding the Chelsea Pottery with his wife, Mary. The New Vision Centre Gallery staged an exhibition of Rawnsley's texture paintings in May 1957, titled A Scale in Abstract, for which Rawnsley wrote a text titled Painting with Time. Looking through the documentation, what becomes clear is that the experimental and multimedial way in which Rawnsley imagined direction and design for film in the independent frame system is carried through into the approach that he took in his post-war painting. A review in What's On describes Rawnsley's aim to bridge the gap between painting and sculpture by providing a medium which combines in itself all the visual elements of texture, form, and color. And a review in The Times summarizes, Mr. Rawnsley has abandoned the painter's brush and called chemical knowledge to his aid in making his abstract designs. The fine webs that are spun across the pictures create objects of great fascination, which invite meandering fancy to weave dreams of science fiction around them. The non-standard methods and materials pursued and deployed by Rawnsley, Blakeston, and others can be seen as an attempt to reckon with the changed material and conceptual post-war world, a science fiction made real. The link between their work and previous experience in film is not coincidental, but demonstrates the persistence of a desire to exploit novel materials in contemporary image making, world making even. The film industry did not ultimately provide the creative or economic conditions for the likes of Blakeston and Rawnsley to flourish. And in the final section of this paper, I want to look at the material conditions of the post-war art world in London and reflect upon the way in which they facilitated or held experimental modes of making. So the Times review of Rawnsley's show that I just quoted from refers to the New Vision Centre Gallery located in the basement of 4 Seymour Place as the Tom Thumb among London's galleries, with its small headquarters situated rather off the beaten track behind Marble Arch. That's a later photograph. In his Artist Lives interview, Dennis Bowen describes the very basic resources with which New Vision was set up, and many other galleries such as Gallery One at 1 Lichfield Street were similarly housed in modest spaces. It was not just galleries, but independent bookshops and publishers who occupied such spaces, for example, Better Books, mentioned at length in a text by Blakeston called Big Little Magazines. He describes, under Cobbing's regime, Better Books has become a meeting place for real book lovers. Poets meet to discuss, and the new wave novelists come from France to lecture. Avant-garde films are shown, and painters exhibit in the cellar. But in an essay on the demise of small publishing in England, Blakeston complained, Charing Cross Road is to be rebuilt, and then the landlords will propose rents which the booksellers will not be able to afford. Many of them at the moment only remain in business because while the old buildings stand, they have a right to remain in their premises at pre-war rents. The truth is that London is losing its fine buildings, which are being recklessly pulled down, its theatres, which are also demolished to make room for rent collectors' slabs of office blocks, its art galleries, which have a platform of avant-garde experiment, its bookshops and its publishers. For Blakeston then, there was a direct but also a metaphoric relationship between the undeveloped physical fabric of the city and its idiosyncratic spaces and the experimental artistic practices existing on the margins of the commercial art world that flourished within. But this is not to say that galleries did not also embrace the new developments that were rising in areas in and around London. Nicholas Treadwell, in addition to running his mobile art gallery from 1963 to 70, and that was a converted furniture removal van going from door to door selling art, he opened his eponymous gallery on St George's Walk in Croydon in 1965. He had met Blakeston through Max Chapman, having been introduced to Max by Aubrey Williams, and staged an exhibition of Blakeston's work that opened in April 1966. Treadwell recalls that on a rainy evening, there were only three visitors to Blakeston's private view in Croydon: John Holmes, the self-taught artist and former meat market porter, John Foster, the managing director of the Streatham branch of John Lewis, and his wife, Mary Foster. On the location, Treadwell summarized that out of the 10 venues his gallery has had, St George's Walk, Croydon was my worst decision. He explained the poor planning of the development by the architects, which became and still is a wind tunnel, remaining empty for many years after completion. Treadwell left the premises in 1968. Well, the present, and we've just learned that it's not present, it actually closed, Barbican exhibition ends in 1965. For Blakeston, it was the year 1967 that marked a downturn in his own fortunes and those of the experimental ventures that he interacted with. It was the year of the devaluation of sterling, causing investors and would-be patrons to retract from potentially unreliable investments. In a letter from December that year, Blakeston predicts that the general collapse will have a bad effect on galleries and publishers, and refers to a show of his that was planned in Bristol but cancelled as a consequence of a top-down directive, "No more modern art." He refers to his recently published Trigram Press pamphlet, titled appropriately, "The Furious Future's Dying," noting, "Trigram started it before the collapse, before Collins closed down Bob Cobbing, the one big outlet for this sort of thing. They certainly wouldn't plan anything like this today in the anti-art atmosphere which has closed so many galleries in the last months, the Hamilton, McRoberts and Tunnard, Tama, Indica, etc." Personally, Blakeston was also facing difficulties at this time. He wrote in 1968, "I'm living out a difficult stage in which I have to look after an invalid, his mother, and I find it harassing to fit in that chore with the art reviewing, painting, and general journalism that has to be done." He nevertheless continued to take opportunities to exhibit his work, now more often straightforward oil paintings and drawings, and watercolours, holding shows at a range of non-specialist venues, including the Questors Theatre Ealing, the Mount Street Post Office, Hornsey Library, Battersea Park Library, Queen Mary College, and Barclays Bank. Intermedial experiment in these circumstances, for Blakeston at least, became more difficult. So the work that I began this presentation with was likely made in the early 1970s. I'm including it with reference to the amazing large-scale Latham work, full stop, that opens the Barbican exhibition, as Blakeston's full stop on two decades of interdisciplinary experiment. So in the post-war years, the production of works variously described as multimedia, dematerialized, or intermedial became more widespread, encouraged through dialogue with pre-war experiment, diaspora perspectives, and the availability of spaces in post-war London. This breakdown of medium specificity and categorization in art was linked by Fluxus artist Dick Higgins to a parallel dismantling of hierarchies of class, nationality, gender, and sexuality. And indeed, the spaces in which these new works were seen were not exclusively the gallery or the museum, but more often the coffee shop and the music venue, thereby linking them to notions of counterculture. As Blakeston wrote in an essay on obscure art, "Writing, painting, and composing are not escapes from life, but ways of life." This alignment of rebellion against the conformity represented by traditional materials and processes in art with a tendency toward politically and socially anti-establishment, consciousness broadening ideals is something that must be continually critically interrogated, however. Post-war artists, gallerists, and works remain selective as to precisely which consciousness-broadening ideals they promoted. Similarly, today, in curatorial, museological, and academic contexts, we must be also aware of the way in which interdisciplinarity in both historic and contemporary work is uncritically invoked or interpreted as serving progressive social, economic, and political purposes. This is both to diminish the complex intentions behind such works, but also, as Annette Michelson has suggested, such focus on the dissolution of distinctions between media can, in effect, occur in lieu of contrastingly impervious social and economic hierarchies and distinctions. Reviewing historical intermedial work in detail helps us remain alert to these subtleties. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Inga. Lots of bewildering, that the energy of the man. He was everywhere doing everything. I can't wait for us to talk more about it. So thank you very much. So I'm now going to introduce Rosie Ram. And Rosie is a visiting lecturer in MA Curating Contemporary Art at the Royal College of Art. And she's the course leader of the Curating Contemporary Art and Design short course programs. In 2021, she completed her AHRC-funded PhD at the RCA, Image as Method, Nigel Henderson and the Art of Research. Rosie is a specialist in modern and contemporary visual culture and curating, whose research has been published across print, film, and online formats. She's curated displays, taught and programmed events at Tate, the Institute of Contemporary Arts, very fittingly, given your subject, Central, St. Martin's, and Chelsea College of Art. Most recently, she co-curated Vital Fragments, Nigel Henderson and the Art of Collage at Tate Britain, and co-convened the international conference and workshop program Cutting Edge Collage in Britain, 1945 to now. Prior to her doctorate, Rosie worked at Chisenhill Gallery in East London. So lots there. And I know that you work a lot with Nigel Henderson's archive too. So looking forward to hearing more about that. So Rosie's paper is called The Negative Logic of Parallel of Life and Art.
Hello, everyone. Thanks so much for being here this evening. And hello and thank you to our audience joining us online as well. And a huge thanks to the Paul Mellon Centre for organising Liquid Crystal Concrete. It's really fantastic to be here and be able to share my research as part of this seminar series. And great to be in dialogue with Inga and with Lucy this evening too. In the period of nearly 70 years since Parallel of Life and Art opened at the Institute of Contemporary Arts in London on the 11th of September 1953, the exhibition has accumulated an almost mythic status in the literature, becoming lauded as a landmark event of the post-war years. Organized collaboratively by artists Nigel Henderson and Eduardo Paolozzi, architects Alison and Peter Smithson, and engineer Ronald Jenkins, Parallel of Life and Art comprised more than 122 photographic images, which had been extracted from highly heterogeneous sources, photographically resized, cropped, and reprinted in black and white. And I'm sure many of you are familiar with Henderson's shots of the hang, which show this complex configuration of monochrome photography crowding the gallery space at the ICA, with prints pinned directly onto the walls, some propped unceremoniously on the floor, and others pasted onto panels that hung from the ceiling in a fractured canopy of overlapping photographic planes suspended just above visitors' heads. Despite its prevalence as a reference point across the scholarship on art in post-war Britain and its increasing prominence in major exhibitions and catalogues on the period, such as Post-War Modern that's recently been on show at the Barbican, I'd like to argue that Parallel of Life and Art remains a challenging object of study, that there is something about the photographically mediated form of the exhibition that seems to evade comprehensive or conclusive analysis. And I'd like to suggest that the locus of this complexity, this ongoing sense of the exhibition's irresolution, resides in the ways in which Parallel of Life and Art invokes the most destabilizing properties of photographic technology. And to make this argument, I want to consider the more unsettling effects of this now infamous exhibition. Presented at a time when photography was largely excluded from the canon of modern visual art in Britain, and while photographs remained almost entirely absent from museological collections in this country, the photographic constitution of Parallel of Life and Art proved controversial. Indeed, when it opened at the ICA, it elicited a critical response characterized by feelings of disturbance and uncertainty, with commentators accusing the exhibition makers of obfuscation, arbitrariness, and even perversion. Reflecting upon the prevalence of this disconcerted critical sentiment, Tom Hopkinson remarked in the Manchester Guardian that, to judge from published comments, the show had proved, quote, disturbing and even repulsive, end quote, to many critics and journalists alike. Even Raina Banham, otherwise an advocate for the project, noted the unnerving effects of this photographic display, remarking that, quote, truth may be stranger than fiction, but many of the camera's statements are stranger than truth itself, end quote. Reading across these published reflections, the critical discomfort elicited by Parallel of Life and Art appears to have derived from a kind of double departure or negation. Not only did the images within the exhibition fail to adhere to the documentary or illustrative function of photography, but they also subverted the codes and conventions governing the artistic context of their presentation. Parallel of Life and Art emptied the gallery of traditional art forms and instead repopulated this valorized space with highly ephemeral photographic materials, materials that, through their explicitly replicated status, dramatically disrupted the traditional tenets of artistic authorship and originality. And in doing so, Parallel of Life and Art deviated from the classificatory criteria, the taxonomies and hierarchies that determine the category of art in post-war Britain, a category from which photography remained overwhelmingly excluded. And these disruptions and deviations are emphasized by the concertina folded catalog that was provided as a kind of guide to accompany the otherwise unlabeled exhibition images, and which details the disparate sources of these photographic materials while categorizing and seemingly miscategorizing them under a series of somewhat oblique headings. These negational maneuvers enacted by Parallel Life and Art, this double departure from both the conventional role of photography as well as from artistic tradition, appears to be at the root of the critical accusations of evasion and even perversion leveled at the exhibition at the time. Staying with these more disturbed critical sentiments, I want to consider how Parallel of Life and Art was able to repurpose photography in this way, as a kind of negational medium, as an inversion of the exclusion of photography from the canon of modern visual art, and at the same time, as an expansion of the emergent category of contemporary art into the realm of the photographic image. To explore this aspect of Parallel of Life and Art, I want to turn next to the research practice from which the exhibition emerged, which saw Henderson, Paolozzi, Jenkins, and the Smithsons meeting on a weekly basis to share and study found images. These meetings were held in the house belonging to Nigel and Judith Henderson at 46 Chisenhill Road in the East End of London. Gathered in the couple's upstairs study, the group would discuss the pictures they had amassed in their scrapbooks and as loose tear sheets and prints, pinning up materials throughout the house to juxtapose images and test out spatialized modes of display. During this extended period of collective visual investigation, the exhibition makers developed a distinctive research methodology. As they sifted through and selected material that seemed to be of shared significance for them, they would convert their chosen images into copy negatives, a stage that they outsourced to a technical printing facility, thereby inserting a further hidden layer of photographic replication, labor, and alteration into the development of the exhibition. These copy negatives, which sit almost invisibly between the found images and the exhibition prints, offer an alternative lens onto Parallel Life and Art and onto its underlying photographic logic. The negatives suspend the project in an intermediate state, a state in which the images remain ever malleable and open to ongoing multiplicity. Here we see the source material of Parallel of Life and Art photographically transformed. Each ghostly image is extracted from its original context and function, reduced to a uniform size, tonally inverted and translucent. These highly ephemeral materials, which are now held in the archive at Tate, bear further traces of the group's collaborative research process of examination, reclassification, and experimental display. Their glassine envelopes have been labeled and relabeled, and the negatives themselves have puncture marks in their corners where they've been pinned up and studied in their negative state. And it's worth highlighting how dramatically different it is to look through and handle these photographic images in negative form, a form in which the image itself feels at once flexible, full of potential, highly sensitive, and photographically unstable. Although not constituted by a traditional artistic material, these negatives functioned as the primary medium of Parallel of Life and Art, permitting the amplifications of photographic tone and texture, the distortions of scale and the dislocations of context, and the jarring incongruities of content that so disturbed its critics. Reflecting upon the development of the display, Henderson argued that, quote, the conception of the exhibition was inseparable from the medium, end quote. And building upon this assertion, I would argue that the underlying logic of Parallel of Life and Art was in fact inseparable from the medium of photographic negativity, from photography's most primal and most volatile state. Indeed, looking through these negatives, and with Henderson's statement in mind, Parallel of Life and Art can be read as rooted in the most disruptive capacities of photography, capacities which are retained by the negative, allowing the ongoing migration, mediation, and manipulation of images, and revealing their irresolution as they undergo technological change. Crucially, the role of photographic negativity within Parallel of Life and Art is reactivated and even elaborated upon within the public hang of the exhibition itself, where we find a small grouping of Henderson's own photographic experiments inserted, if somewhat obliquely, among the photographically replicated contents of the display. Often referred to by his peers using the hybridized term artist-photographer with the two words hyphenated, Henderson's role is critical here because of the uncertain and interstitial position he himself occupied between art and photography at this time. Appearing in a loose configuration at one end of the gallery, Henderson's four photographic experiments included a triptych of distorted images of male bathers made from a Victorian glass lantern slide, a contact print produced using a piece of decaying mirror, a photochemical palm print that had been dramatically enlarged, and a photogram created from discarded coffee grounds. Importantly, these four photographic experiments are distinct from the rest of the pictures that comprise Parallel of Life and Art, in that they do not straightforwardly represent enlarged photographic reproductions of found images per se. Instead, created through artistic intervention in the darkroom, intervention at the technological level of the negative, these images seem almost surreptitiously inserted among the hang, given their departure from the group's overarching protocol of sourcing ready-made pictures and subjecting these to photographic reproduction. Indeed, Henderson's four photographic experiments trouble photography's straightforwardly reproductive role. As if intent on studying these alternative forms of photography within Parallel of Life and Art, many of Henderson's installation shots focus upon this particular portion of the hang, revealing interactions between the photographic experiments and their neighboring pictures. For instance, if we turn first to Henderson's triptych of photographically distorted male bathers captured undressing on an unknown shore, we can read these figures in dialogue with an adjacent image, a photographic reproduction of a painting by Picasso titled The Bathers and dated 1923. Here we see Henderson's photographic distortion entering into a direct, and I would argue photographically negational, confrontation with modern painting, and by extension with the entrenched artistic traditions of painterly skill, authorial status, and form. While in Picasso's piece, the figures become contorted through the conventional artistic media and technique of paint and brush on canvas executed in the artist's studio, Henderson achieves a comparable level of contortion by folding and creasing the photosensitive paper in the darkroom during the printing process, while projecting the found Victorian image through the glass lantern slide. Within Parallel of Life and Art, not only does this pairing show modern painting subsumed into the photographic display, but it also deftly inserts the photographically manipulated image into the valorized realm of painting, a maneuver that is made possible by the flexibility of the image in its negative state. As if to dramatize the dialogue, on the back cover of the catalogue, Henderson selects an intriguing professional title, identifying himself here as painter and photographer, despite rarely painting during the period and claiming little proficiency or even interest in the medium. And it's interesting to note that in the rest of the marketing material produced around the exhibition, the word painter remains absent until we enter Parallel of Life and Art and find these manipulated photographic images invading the traditional territory of painting. Read in proximity with the bathers, Henderson's chosen title can be seen as playing off the pairing like a pun, Picasso and Henderson, painter and photographer. This confrontation between painting and photography that we find submerged within Parallel of Life and Art is extended if we look just to the right of Henderson's bather images. Here we can see a shot of the American abstract expressionist painter Jackson Pollock in his Long Island studio, captured by the German photographer Hans Nemuth in 1950 and deriving from a series of pictures of Pollock taken by Nemuth at this time, which have since become some of the most iconic images of the painter at work, used not only to inflate his individual celebrity, but also to propagate the mythology of the studio itself as a source of artistic genius and heroism. Building upon the interaction between the painted and photographic bathers, this depiction of the modern painter at work in his studio can also be read in dialogue with another of Henderson's darkroom experiments. Hanging just in front, face down in parallel with the ceiling, was an image entitled Disintegrating Mirror Contact Print, and identified as coming from the collection of Nigel Henderson. This image had been produced in the darkroom by placing a decaying mirror directly onto photosensitive paper before exposing the arrangement to light, creating an abstract pattern of tangled lines which, when placed into the hang of Parallel of Life and Art, echoed the paint-spattered surfaces of Pollock's studio. As if to extend the fractured patterning from the painter's floor and walls onto the ceiling of the exhibition. And again, here we see a trope of modern painting disrupted photographically. In Parallel of Life and Art, the modernist sanctuary of the artist's studio is ruptured and relocated. The interior world of the studio becomes photographically extracted and transferred, partially into the hidden zone of the darkroom, and partially into the contemporary art gallery, while at the same time, as with the bathers, replacing paint, brush, and canvas with photochemicals and found materials. And together, these photographically negational maneuvers trouble one of the most fundamental traditions of painting, the authorial touch, status, and skill of the artist's hand. Indeed, within Parallel of Life and Art, the question and role of the artist's hand loomed large. Suspended centrally within the disorientating display was Henderson's photochemical palm print, executed in black and white and blown up to dramatic, even grotesque proportions. The fingerless photographic palm hung vertically from the ceiling, positioned just in front of the horizontal disintegrating mirror panel and perpendicular to the wall displaying the image grid that included both Henderson's and Picasso's bathers and Nemuth's photograph of Jackson Pollock painting. Henderson's photographic handprint is likely to have been made using a form of cameraless photography that later became known as the chemigram method. In chemigram photography, an object, in this case the artist's hand, is placed into photographic developer fluid and then onto photosensitive paper to make a print, which is exposed to light before being stopped with fixer. This print can then be photographically reproduced, translated into negative, and enlarged using a photographic enlarger. Given its central location within Parallel of Life and Art, Henderson's palm print raises the question of how to reconceptualize artistic skill in relation to the photographically mediated exhibition. Coated in developer fluid, the photochemical palm print creates the direct evidentiary trace of individual creative handling during photographic image production. In doing so, the hand could be seen to reinsert itself back into the creative process, repositioning itself as the sort of source of artistic skill, subjectivity, and authorship after the advent of photographic reproducibility, and in spite of the prevalence of the photographic image as a ready-made commodity. Here then, artistic skill can be seen as relocated from the modernist work of painting to a collaborative, transdisciplinary and highly technologized kind of research practice. One tasked with interrogating the function of the photographic image in the post-war world and testing the capacity of contemporary art to serve as an emergent space capable of sustaining this kind of investigation. Most critically, perhaps, Parallel of Life and Art represents this form of research as unfinished, as suspended in the ongoing process of image reproduction, translation, and analysis. And this is evident if we turn to the shots Henderson took of the display after it had been hung, where we find the exhibition returned once again into photographic form, and importantly, into the primal state of negativity. Here, Parallel of Life and Art itself becomes a negative image, darkly translucent and miniaturized, reduced to the status and scale of the negatives that were used to construct it. This final maneuver returns the shots of the exhibition to the research process from which it emerged, a research process that is recorded in the negative state of these complex archival materials. Studying these images allows an alternative analysis of Parallel of Life and Art, one that moves from thinking about the photographic image as a fixed pictorial form to reconceptualizing the photograph as itself processual. And seen through this lens, the exhibition can be reconceived as constituting a kind of ongoing investigation into the post-photographic visual world and into the function of contemporary art in this rapidly advancing technological context. At the time it was presented, as I've argued, the photographic constitution of Parallel of Life and Art posed a profound challenge to artistic tradition, to canonical structures, and to the definition and value of art upheld by museological conventions. And just before I finish, I want to reflect on the afterlife of the exhibition and the complexity of accessing these materials in their most destabilizing photographic state. Stored within the archive at Tate, the negative traces of Parallel of Life and Art become a kind of invisible presence. In the reading rooms and on the museum's website, positive proxies are provided in the place of these negatives, as the assumption is that audiences and researchers are looking for the pictorial content of the images in their correct and natural form as printed or digital positives. The negatives are thereby concealed, becoming instead a kind of dark shadow archive of the exhibition, submerged beneath the visible surfaces of the museum. And I think it says a lot about the uneasy relationship photography continues to have with visual art in Britain, particularly within museological space. So just as Parallel of Life and Art presented a kind of negative provocation to the institutional structures governing the category of art in the post-war period, I think its shadow archive of photographic negatives continues to pose a complex provocation to the ways in which photography is allowed to function within the art museum today.
So thanks very much. Lots to talk about, I'm sure lots of questions. So I think, did you want to come sit in perch on the edge? So, before I was thinking, shall I look to see what bridges we can make, similarities across your papers and the subjects that you're looking at? Shall I ask direct questions to you? The one thing I do feel that is interesting to me about what the show is doing in 53 and what Oswald was doing throughout his extraordinary life, something about excess, which seems very different from our notion of the kind of post-war modernism as being something clean, pure, and all of them embrace this idea of, what did I write, precarity, instability, it's in flow, the use of detritus. You talk about magic lantern slides, but the use of a kind of indexical type of photography and process, but also books, writing, that idea of text, but text which is concrete poetry, but also, you know, review writing. I mean, it's it seems to absolutely go against our perceived notions of what the kind of rather more homogenized idea that we have of modernism. So I don't know, am I completely off key there, or do you both think there's something in that?
Yeah, I could say, yeah. I mean, the word that we said before was that this work is sort of almost unexhibitable, yeah. And it never will be part of a kind of main narrative of post-war British art, or, you know, in a variety of contexts, because, as you say, the negatives are in a box. You're advised not to handle them. You know, Blakeson's works have disintegrated, evaporated, whatever. So, yeah, I think that is a kind of good observation. Yeah.
Mm. I think it's also that question, and I think for Parallel of Life and Art, it's like what the kind of increasing amount of stuff, and as you say, the kind of detritus of the pre-war and the interwar period, you know, what do we do with all the stuff that we're left over with, and the kind of ruins and the kind of material around that, and then also what do we do with the kind of exponential increasing of production, for instance, of images? You know, it's like that, what to do with the kind of ruins of the past, but also the exponential production of the present.
And would you say that, you know, often again the narrative we're given looks to British pop art as being something which is a response to a kind of consumer excess, but I think this is something a little different. And again, I was looking at the catalogue for the show, and there was Metzer and others. I'm thinking about, you know, Trocky, about Jeff Nuttall, that whole extraordinary, slightly grimy, if I can say that, world of that time, which was generating such extraordinary work. So again, I wonder what you think about how we might not make connections, neat kind of teleologies towards pop art and British pop art or so on. Good to get your thoughts on that.
I think Parallel of Life Art is absolutely about this. I mean, as I said at the beginning of my talk, it's unresolved, you know, its unresolved character makes it so generous, generative for us to kind of think about today. And the fact also that I think that these collaborative projects, they don't need, you know, you can't neatly resolve them. And I think they're about that kind of the uncertainty of that moment as well. And absolutely. They kind of, their aesthetics kind of hold that uncertainty, and they're fractured as well, kind of formally fractured. And I think that speaks to what you're talking about, absolutely.
And I sort of, on an individual level, Blakeson couldn't quite decide where to place his work and, you know, what he was going to be. And you can argue, looking at some of the documentation in his archives, that actually he wanted to be a writer. And he kind of turned to painting, as a... because I think there's some letters between him and Breyer that talk about people aren't interested in text anymore, they're only interested in the visual. So he was kind of trying to kind of express himself according to the mode of the day. And then there's this additional kind of overhang from film and how that itself kind of frames an intermediality, which, you know, is similar with photography.
I was just gonna say, we were also talking about that idea of what to name these kinds of work or practice or these forms of labour that don't yet have a name. And these, you know, I mentioned that Henderson was known as artist photographer, because it's almost like the two had to be, there was something unresolved in that pairing as well. And as Inga's talking about those kind of forms of work that weren't yet kind of identified what they are. Are they creative practices? What are their kind of disciplinary traditions? I think it's really interesting.
And I think also what's interesting as well, I mean, that interdisciplinarity is, I mean, that's, we're so used to that today, but think about research-based practice for PhDs and so on. It's something, but it's taken a long time for us to get to that point where you're not sort of placed with one medium only and told you have to stay with that. But I was also interested, again, not only in the very exciting unresolved aspect of their work, the kind of endlessness of it somehow, particularly that fantastic show, but also that both of them, and we talked a little bit about this before, didn't we, they're sort of bridge, and perhaps that uncertainty comes from that. They bridge a pre and post-war period, and I mean, I know certainly if you think about the involvement of Blakeston with close-up and that very particular and exciting moment in film when he was making work himself. And also, I know you were saying I know less about Henderson, that he as well was very involved in.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, he was slightly older than the kind of independent group, Milieu, born in 1917, and his wife was the niece of Virginia Woolf, and his mother was Wynne Henderson, who was working with Peggy Guggenheim on the Guggenheim Journal Gallery. And it's also those kind of energies from Dada and Surrealism and Bloomsbury and that kind of moment after the war of what do we do with these? You know, that assumption that they've kind of gone underground and then we're in this new kind of technological context and the very way, the environment in which people were working in, but where do those kind of energies go? And I think Henderson was absolutely a sort of conduit between the pre-war and interwar period and post-war.
It's not just, you know, like Blake, other painters who are kind of peers of Blake's and also expressed this in unsurety about technology and what it meant to be a painter in a kind of technological environment. There's a great quote in the Imra Caesar film of Aubrey Williams, right at the very end, he's being interviewed by Guy Brett, and he says, you know, this anxiety about technology, we're not keeping a pace with technology, and that informs his work as a painter.
But that's interesting, isn't it? Because at the same time that they're picking up, I want to come to this as a question for you in a minute, Rosie, at the same time that they're picking up images of ancient statues in negative or magic lantern slides or exhibiting in coffee shops because they can't find anywhere else, they're also being told to look ahead to technology. Mm-hmm. So in a sense, it's both a looking back to that kind of ruination, mm-hmm. Which has come after the war, but also the kind of white-heated technology that they're also expected. So there's a real confliction mm-hmm. there, I think. The other thing, of course, we haven't mentioned is that it's a post-atomic time. I mean, this is, this is post-Hiroshima. And what was it? Jeff Nuttall said mm-hmm. that, didn't he? He said, we are the Hiroshima generation. So I imagine that that's imbuing very much, or unless you, again, this is, you know, am I wildly out of
No, all there? Of the kind of Blake's inside of circle that he exhibited with as a painter, Halima Nalic, Dennis Bowen, all of it, you know, there's the kind of nuclear series. There was one that featured very briefly on a slide by Halima Nalic, which is called Nuclear Image. They were all kind of working within that as a kind of dominant feature of their culture.
Yeah, I kind of wondered about that. Even the crystal pictures,
there's a sense of that. Yeah.
But can I ask you, Rosie, I mean, this is maybe a bit of a dumb question, but the choice of images in the show, where did they come from? I love the way you talked about their kind of translucency, and I was thinking about this idea of layering and, again, of the kind of precarity of looking through the image and looking around it. But why did they write much about their rationale for the show?
Yeah, so the kind of methodology that they developed, so initially there wasn't the explicit intention for it to be an exhibition. They were just meeting at Henderson's house and kind of sharing tear sheets, books. It was a real disparate sources of images and thinking about the notion of the image kind of conceptually, really trying to kind of get to grips with what images are and how they function and how they can be made to kind of re-function or re-perform by extracting them from different contexts. So a lot of it is kind of collage source material, it's things from their scrap, they were often all keeping scrapbooks, and I showed those images of Henderson's house, but pinning things up around that is really the kind of found detritus. And I think that what you are speaking to also, that huge kind of breadth of history that those images come from, but they aren't, and I think that's what Parallel of Life and Art kind of sits in a funny position in relation to the kind of conventional idea of pop art as being kind of the modern moment. They're not modern, those images, you know, and that's kind of amazing, that kind of deep history and the kind of trans-historical form of the exhibition because of that methodology that they developed. I think really interesting.
And that's also reckoning with psychology, and obviously, you know, Henderson's partner had this kind of was she like one of the first psychoanalysis people to be
her parents
her parents were.
Yeah.
And that the, when you mention them kind of all sitting around in Henderson's house, like looking at the images, you get the kind of, this is the kind of spectre of the Bloomsbury Salon, you know, cribbing
yeah,
each other's
yeah.
literary work, but instead now looking at images and the kind of, the history of the image kind of being supplanted onto the kind of history
yeah,
of one's
and
own
the, and
mind.
The domestic context as yeah. well, and that kind of, the decorative modes of display, using the house as a context to kind of test mm. out the exhibition mm. in a very kind of partial and fragmented form, but you see it on the shelves in the house, pinned up on the walls, these mm-hmm. kind of fragments of parallel life and art that have this very interesting, I think, relationship to the final exhibition itself.
So in a sense, it's what we would today call research-based practice in a way, isn't it? But it, in a really extraordinary, I was thinking of the Eames as well, I don't know mm. if they were anywhere in the picture
yeah,
there, but
yeah,
they,
yeah.
they came to mind. But I should open, I shouldn't keep you all to myself, I really should open up to the floor and the online floor too. Does anybody have any questions?
I'll get my steps in.
Hello. Both papers focused very rewardingly on individual figures, right? Named individuals, and offered little snippets of biography and little, you know, bits of information about who these people were. I wonder if you could both elaborate a bit more on that kind of biographical question about who they were, where they came from. And I ask that pointedly, with a bit of pointedness, because it's striking that both practices, as we've been hearing about in this discussion, were very focused on precarity, on being unsustainable in effect. And you sort of wonder, well, what is it which makes unsustainable practices sustainable? And is there anything in their biographies, is there any common ground as well between these two lives that might be kind of worth exploring a bit more?
For Blakeston, so he came, his family were like fairly middle class, and but he kind of, I think, on account of his sexuality, he kind of felt quite alienated from them, so he kind of left home at 16 and kind of you know, ended up working in the film industry. So I think biography for Blakeston was a really important way for me understanding his work, because there's so much and it covered so much territory. Like, the reason why my paper was three times as long was because I kind of wrote it and was like, and then he knew that person and they knew that person, and you know, they're not kind of coincidental things. Kind of wrote about them in depth, you know, spanning his own kind of work as a critic as well, and he was very loyal to a lot of his kind of friends and kind of peers, and would kind of write up their shows in various publications that he wrote about. So I guess biography in terms of this narrative, this path, was really important as a structure for me. And if I had another like hour I could kind of fill that out a bit more, but I don't think there was any actual crossover with Henderson. I have not read any reference. So the kind of, we were talking about this earlier, the key split comes because under the auspices of the ICA, the Free Painters and Sculptors group formed, which was Dennis Bowen and Halima Nalic, some of the founders, and they sort of started exhibiting at Dover Street and then kind of went off on their own and kind of detached from the ICA. And then I guess Henderson and Paolozzi were, you know, like, Blakeston never mentions
Blakeston in contemporary film. It's kind of interesting, contemporary artist film.
He doesn't really get to it until the late 70s. He must have had some through Cobbing, but like, it doesn't feature in his criticism until the late 70s. And that's when his own work starts to be of interest. So there's the kind of big Haywood shows, the Film is Film show in 78, and I think there was a 30s show, and there was a David Meller curated a sort of British photography show around that time. So you get all these letters and people writing to Blakeston, can we borrow your work, does it still exist? And then he goes to the Film is Film, so he hates Malcolm McGrath.
Oh, I'm longing to hear more about this.
He doesn't rate it at all. So you know, his own kind of comments on his own experimental work are quite dismissive, like from that point. So yeah, that continues.
It sounds in a way like he's, and again, being a gay man at that time when it was still illegal, of mm-hmm. course, he had to have multiple selves, didn't he? And that
yeah.
really is reflected, and we were just talking about psychoanalysis, but that really does seem to be reflected in the way that he works across media somehow.
It's very heartwarming in his archive because he becomes embraced by like the community at a later stage. So he kind of writes articles for Gay News and they kind of write things about him as an elder. So I think, you know, like he almost gets a kind of a place at the end of his life and he kind of is able to be open in some way.
Yeah, I think in relation to Henderson, it's a really good question. I mean, perhaps similarly, he came from an upper middle class background, and I think that idea of what the enabled him to be precarious and to kind of sustain a precarious practice in that way. And his wife, as we were talking about, Judith Henderson, was a socio-anthropologist who was working on a project called Discover Your Neighbor, which was a descendant of mass observation. And as part of that, they were kind of given that house in East London so that she could do her research from there, 46 Chisnell Road. And so the kind of infrastructure of support that enabled that very precarious practice is a really interesting one as well. But I think that question of biography in relation to Parallel of Life and Art specifically is really interesting, because I think part of that collaborative research process that they adopted kind of obscured their end. I mean, I know I kind of unpick it in relation to Henderson and kind of read that function of the artist photographer role in relation to the way that photography operates in that exhibition. I kind of use his role in that as a kind of device to think about photography, but equally you could think about, you could read the exhibition very differently if you thought about the Smithsons, or if you thought about Ronald Jenkins, the engineer, or Paolozzi. So I think it's interesting that the methodology that they devised and the way that photography kind of extracted the images from their individual, maybe kind of biography or their individual practices, and kind of disguise them through that process of replication and then put them into the display, it kind of obscures the individual in a way. And I think that's part of the exhibition, and it's part of what makes it so rich in terms of the ways in which you can read it.
I think another thing, just to speak back to you, is I think they really both reject the auteurist notion of the single artist, don't they? Because it's networked all the time, isn't it? Even if he's got many versions of himself, but he's networked to so many different artists, architecture, engineer. It seems that they have a kind of restless curiosity on one level, but also they want to resist being turned into the artist par excellence who does one thing, who shows in a certain way. Would I be right in thinking that they really quite consciously were, or maybe even unconsciously, rejecting that kind of model?
Yeah, I think there's a kind of tension there between, because it's not an entire kind of relinquishing of authorship. And I think, you know, I showed the back cover of the Parallel of Life Art catalogue, where Henderson, that statement of painter and photographer, that you could read that the other way, that he's kind of asserting his artistic status in relation to the exhibition. So I think there is a tension, and I think perhaps often in collaborative projects, of kind of wanting to relinquish authorial status and yet still naming oneself and kind of claiming a certain position around that. And I think also that changes kind of historically, particularly in relation to Parallel of Life and Art, as it becomes mythologized and kind of monumentalized and becomes a kind of work of art, then authorship around it, there's a kind of higher stakes to claim an authorial position. So I think, and you see that with the independent group, but with Paolozzi, you know, the association with these what become kind of landmark events, I think the claims to authorship also shift over time.
Just to say that Blakeston's name is a kind of compound name, so Blakeston was his mother's surname, and Oswell is a composite of Osbert Sitwell. So his kind of whole artistic identity is a kind of knowing.
Does this answer your question? Or maybe just bring on more.
Sorry.
Just keep it going.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Or just behind you. Yeah.
Thanks. Thanks very much for those talks. Fascinating. My question is about Rose's talk, and especially the way in which photography is positioned. And I really like the idea of Henderson's work being about a kind of conflict between painting and photography. But I want to bring in the actual space here and the experience of being in that space, which surely was a major contributory factor in the, you know, critics reacting to its disturbing and even confusing nature. Because, you know, if we can focus, say, on that handprint picture by Henderson, that is skied, you know, it's right beside the ceiling in that space, as indeed are many of the pictures. Or they're propped against the floor, you know, they're on the angle between floor and wall. And so when you talk about relocation, which you were talking about in a kind of metaphorical sense, we could actually talk about relocation in a kind of phenomenological sense in that space. You know, it would have made it very difficult to actually see as pictures some of the images which are skied. How do you respond to that?
I think it's really good point. And it's interesting, you know, I was talking about the research that their kind of methodology of finding those images and kind of testing out spatialized modes of display in the house at 46 Chisholm Hill Road. And in Henderson's and other photographs of that house, you see them pinning up materials on the ceiling. And it's really interesting that kind of testing out of the ceiling as a surface of display. And I think it's, yeah, and then in comparison to the picture of Pollock's studio, where you have the floor as the kind of space in which marks are made, and coming back to the Bloomsbury group as well, they're thinking of the decorative and how that kind of taking on the decorative space, transplanting that into the exhibition space is really interesting. And I think it's also why Henderson's shots of the exhibition are so interesting, because they really they show different ways of looking at the exhibition, and they frame very particular groupings of material, and they're often kind of angled upwards. So they're directing the gaze at kind of unusual, they're not conventional installation photographs. They're particularly kind of focused on testing out ways of looking, ways of framing, using the camera. He uses two different kinds of, he uses a roller cord camera and a plate camera to photograph the space. So you also have different kind of ways of cropping images and looking at the overlaps of images as well. So I think that that's very much part of what's being kind of tested in that space.
I think there's also something interesting about, I don't know, what you both feel around the kind of utopian attitude towards technology. And I wondered if that was coming into it as well. I mean, I love to see that both Ian Palazzi, who were both teaching at LCC, as it then was, and really getting their hands on the stuff in quite a kind of physical way, but exploring what was available to them. And also that quite clearly that Blakeston was really enjoying trying all these different media. But do you think the fact there was an engineer involved in the show, and sort of looking ahead to the artist placement group, and there was in some sense a utopian attitude that we wouldn't have now around the use of different technologies?
I think, yeah, possibly, but also kind of, I think Ronald Jenkins and I could have done a whole other kind of reading of his role in the exhibition, but also a kind of necessity of, and I think that's what collaboration speaks to as well, of needing different kinds of expertise and coming back to that idea of the complexity of that hang and that kind of spatialized, you know, working with architects, working with an engineer, and the way that they had this kind of lattice of wires across the ceiling that they used to suspend those images in that way. And so it's also kind of bringing together those different modes of kind of technical and technological expertise in order to make a project like that kind of realizable together, I think.
Anything you'd add?
Oh, I mean, yeah, well, kind of, you know, like pick and mix with technology, and, you know, the other gallery that he exhibited with as a painter was the Grabowski Gallery, which is owned by Mateusz Grabowski, who was a chemist in Chelsea, and, you know, he delighted in kind of a kind of amateurish like approach to technology, I guess.
Fascinating, also the idea of the amateur as well, as opposed to having the engineer, you know,
yeah.
it's a
again, part of that unresolvedness that they both play with in a way.
Lucy, we had a question from online, but just to say someone's left a comment saying really enjoyed both talks and that they weren't aware of both artists. So I think as well, it's quite interesting, isn't it? When we, if you're familiar with this period, like a figure like Henderson, is, you know, it's entered into research and the conversation, but actually, you know, wider histories or more canonical histories as well, that these figures are not fully accounted for, or the networks and the gallery spaces in which they were operating, you know, are sort of in and out of the history. So just, that was a really comment, interesting comment from one of our online audiences who's like meeting these artists for the first time through your talks.
Did you say that you also had an online question?
No, it was that comment. Yeah,
where do you want to go next? So, James,
my question, which I suppose is sort of about mediation, but it's to do with whether you think of these artists as being, at the time they were working, kind of coterie artists who are making work kind of for members of their own circle. Because even though the artists you're talking about, Inga, are working kind of in publications, or in tension and mediation, you do get a sense, just actually from minutes to do that, we both used kind of archival images. Sense to it. But I kind of wondered how broadly you think this work might have circulated beyond London. I'm kind of asking this because there are some artists that I've been working on in working in York a lot like that work, who did know Aubrey Williams. I'm kind of wondering, is that a personal thing, or are these things actually circulating more broadly?
For Blakeston, definitely it was. There's, I think, through a great Yarmouth Central Library, he did a show at gallery in Colchester, Gallery 60, kind of more into the late 60s and 70s. He did a couple of shows in, Harrow.
Don't forget Croydon.
And Croydon. But it was great to London now. He kind of very much took every opportunity. And some of them are quite surprising and quite like genteel as well. The Arran Arts Centre in the south, my UK geography being a bit rubbish. But that was with Gwen Barnard, who was one of the co-directors of Gavin Brooker's Press, Aubrey Williams, Max Chapman. So, you know, these artists were certainly circulating, and definitely through New Vision. Like, he had a lot of contacts up in the northeast, and Blakeston's work was kind of followed those lines. He also exhibited in Toronto and Germany in the 60s, but I think it was circulating, but it was very much part of like a particular scene.
I think it's interesting, those the criticism that I talked about in the beginning of my talk, you know, the Manchester Guardian is, and I think that the ICA had a kind of, and some of that criticism, you read it and you get a sense that people are going, or the critics are going to the ICA to be kind of shocked and scandalized, and that there's a kind of a sort of certain thrill in that, and then writing these very scathing reviews. So I think that that's part of the kind of function of the exhibition, is positioning it within the ICA, and also the ICA in its title making a certain claim to be contemporary rather than modern. And I think that's a really interesting part of that kind of bit, what its function is in that space.
Just going through the press cuttings books from the New Vision Gallery as well, it's still surprising to read how like absolutely critical like the mainstream press were of abstract art, like just generally, like it doesn't even need to be like photography hung on the ceiling. It's like they hated it.
Yeah. Mark, I think you had a question.
I just wondered what the kind of work that the two of you are doing feels like in relation to a kind of broader re-description of British art post-war. I mean, whether you see, I'd just be interested to think if you could just step back a bit from your specific projects and see, and what kind of directions you see the kind of work that you're both doing taking the histories of British art since the war. I wondered whether it was part, there's a way in which the kind of what you're doing is a reaction against that very dominant canon of painters, especially, who are seen to be, you know, that are traditionally, and the market certainly, seem to be these towering figures in in the post-war period, and whether the kind of work you're doing on practices and figures who are not part of that very familiar story of, you know, Bacon and Freud and Back and all those. Mm. Yeah, I'm just interested to see what's going on now with the show and with the work you did. This series is illuminating, even conference illuminated, in relation to the kind of histories of post-war British art and direction and scope.
I think it's interesting because it's not like these galleries and figures like are not discussed, you know, like there are, you know, displays at Tate Britain, there are conferences, you know, organised by the Paul Mellon Centre that kind of deal with them periodically. But I guess looking at the work and, you know, like seeing how hard it is to just like even pull together some images, I really tried. It's never gonna be canonized, and I don't think it should be canonized, but like it's always gonna have to exist in this kind of like, you know, recurrent, like, oh, have you thought about Nigel Henderson and Roswell Blakeson? No, let's look at it now, and then it will go back in the archive for 10 years and then come out again. It's never going to be kind of canonized, and I guess it's just part of a kind of recurrent, like, in the same way that, you know, there's a Bacon exhibition every 6 years or something. There's little conferences and papers about more peripheral figures, I guess.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. I think that kind of, but the kind of interstitial and ephemerality mm-hmm. of it makes, and I think what I was talking to you initially about with Parallel Life Night, it's challenging, you know, it's, and I think that's the kind of, it's archival location now, you know, it doesn't sit in the collection at Tate, it sits in the archive in this very kind of distributed and fragmented state. It's kind of difficult to hold its totality because it's so ephemeral and kind of interstitial as a form of work. But I think also there's something really interesting with Henderson now that Tate have digitized the negatives and they're available as online images, and the way that they kind of circulate online, and that also just how many of them that there are. But as I kind of was talking about at the end of my talk, they're actually negatives, a lot of them. So they don't exist as positives, but now they become very kind of familiar as positive images. So there's something interesting, I think, about doing this kind of research with so much access to online, these materials online, but then I think there's also a danger there where we can't necessarily access them in their archival and kind of material form. That the way that we research in online space is very, very different. And I think that I don't quite know how that becomes kind of resolved.
It's so interesting that you say that they're not on display, they're in the archive. Just like, I spend a lot of time complaining as someone who works in moving image, it's in the education room. It's not in the gallery. So it's almost a sense, going back to that rather tiresome Benjaminian idea of the awe of the art object, that somehow these practices aren't necessarily peripheral, but because of their very
material traces
that, and I know I used the word their excess before, but actually their networkness, their, in which really speaks of technology, actually, in a way, they're difficult to grasp, difficult to buy, difficult to put in a collection, to put on a wall. Perhaps that, and it's probably pretty obvious, perhaps that's one of the reasons that, as you say, they get taken out for a while, mm-hmm. we're looking at a certain radical moment, mm-hmm. and then they get put back again.
But also, that's what I was trying to get at in the last section of my paper about the spatial kind of configuration of these works at the time, is that ends up being replicated in a museological setting, is that, as you go with the avant-garde film, mm-hmm. it's in the bloody basement.
It's in the bloody basement,
That's where it was at the time, it was in the basement on Charing Cross Road, and that's where it is now, but it's just in the basement.
Well, today at least, we brought it out of the basement. It's here in the middle of the centre, British Centre for Art at Paul Mellon. Thank you so much, and I know you had a question, Matthew, but I think I will get into trouble if I let you ask it, but you'll just have to ask the speakers later. Thank you so much to everyone who came today, and to two such fantastic panelists and papers, and looking forward to seeing them in print, Oswald would like that, I know, and to more discussions around this really interesting period. So thank you very much to everyone for coming, and we'll wait for the next.